spotless are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Sounding good, let's sing this. Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin.
Lay aside your garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
You see?
Are you washed?
Yes, I'm
washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Come
in your soul, cleansing blood of the Lamb.
Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Oh, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Oh, you sound good tonight. Go ahead and be seated, all right? I told you I love quartet music. I asked a few friends of mine several years ago if they would come and sing along with me. So you'll hear them on the track. Good old quartet, I love it. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. This is a good song.
Well, I'm on battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Well, I promised to him that I would serve him till I die. Now I am on the battlefield for my Lord. Well, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on the battlefield for my
master's hand,
and I joined that heavenly band. Now I am on the battlefield for my Lord. Well, now I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. You know that I would serve
this song, and I think you will too. Well, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Be alright, it's gonna be alright. It'll be alright. God sent Moses to lead his people out, but Pharaoh's heart was hardened and he thought he'd give them a route. So he chased them all down to the Red Sea shore. He thought he wouldn't have to worry about old Moses anymore. But Moses stretched his rod out over the sea, and God answered Moses with a little gentle breeze. I can see Moses now, the smile on his face, helping all those people with his gentle grace. Well, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. It's gonna be alright. Be alright. Be alright. A little boy named David went out to fight the giant, and everyone laughed at such a funny sight. A shepherd boy armed only with a sling next to old Goliath seemed like such a puny thing. But David said, "You come to me with spear and a sword, but I come to you in the name of the Lord." He put in a stone and he gave it a fling, and when it left his hand, David, he began to sing. I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I've got a feeling that everything's gonna be alright. There we go. Oh, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. It's gonna be alright. Be alright. Be alright. Now for the greatest story of them all. Jesus was dying and hell was having a ball. All the demons were rejoicing, they thought they'd won the war, but soon they would not be laughing anymore. On that first Easter morning when the sun woke up the earth, caverns of the deep opened up just to give birth to a resurrected Savior with healing in his wings. Devils and children can rise and sing. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I got a feeling, oh, everything's gonna be it's gonna be alright. Be alright. Be alright. It's gonna be alright. Be alright. It'll be alright. Alright, amen. Yeah. No matter what the world throws at you, the darts of the enemy, it's gonna be alright if you've accepted Jesus as your Savior. I really want to do just a little bit more if that's alright. Yeah. Well, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I've got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I've got a feeling that everything's gonna be alright. Be alright, be alright, be alright. It's gonna be alright, be alright, be alright.
It's going to be all right. Because we already figured out last night, he doesn't preach, so it's going to be all right. He doesn't preach, I don't sing, so it's going to be all right. Amen. Amen. What a blessing that is. Did you bring some CDs with you tonight?
I did. They're
Okay. Brother Cody has some CDs. Afterwards, he'll be around, and he'll probably say it again after a while, but he said last night, if you don't have the money, don't let that stand in your way. Get that music. That's way better than anything Waylon Willie will ever put out. Okay? At least most of this crowd still knows Waylon and Willie. You know, so, you might not admit to it, but you still know who they are. Amen? And so anyway, what a blessing that is. Ushers, would you come tonight? And we're going to take an offering and just try to do what God would have us to do. But what a blessing it is to be able to sing like that. Amen. And we look forward to the rest of what tonight's going to hold for us. Amen. Brother Lee, would you lead us in a word of prayer?
Father, thank you for this wonderful Crusade that we've had and the great singing and the preaching. And Lord, that bless this crowd that's here tonight and bless this afternoon. And so people give to that. And thank you for all you do for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Such a good time, and I have been looking so forward to every single night. I'm looking forward to what God's going to do tonight and tomorrow morning. It's just been such a sweet time coming home back to Sara Road and seeing so many of you and some I haven't seen in so long, but it's just been a great time. Back a few weeks ago on Easter Sunday, Steve Weatherford was here, and a very dear friend, a longtime friend of the Weatherfords, Miss Paige Perry, came up and sang, and she's going to come up. Go ahead and head on up here, Paige. And loves the Lord with all of her heart. She's got a beautiful voice. She's going to sing a couple of songs for you, and then Brother Jay will come up, all right? And do you want to say anything first? All right, even better. You go ahead and sing, all right?
No. I don't preach either, so I just sing. For it seemed I'd not survive.
joy that overflows. I've won, the victory has come. Though the enemy still makes his presence known, I planted my feet in the Word of God. He fought the battle I've won. I know there'll be more battles that we'll fight from day to day. Lord, clothe me in your armor as I take up my shield of faith. Lord, you are my stronghold. My heart will not fear. With your word as my weapon, I know the victory is near.
Said, if you've read the book, if you've read the whole book, if you've read the back of the book, we win.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We win. And if you're here tonight and you don't know that, and you don't know Jesus, please, any one of us here, get with me, get with Cody,
Amen.
Get with Brother Jay,
Amen.
Any one of us here that knows the Lord would love to share with you what He's done for us.
Amen.
God, or guys, this is not the time, the times that we're living in, this is not the time that you want to be without Jesus.
Amen.
I'm just going to tell you that. Battles come at me every day, and I think the last couple of years, I've had more heartaches and more struggles in my mind than I've had in my whole life, just because the enemy is real,
right.
And he'll come at you when he knows that you're not his.
Right.
And I know that he can't get me, he can't ever have me, he can't ever pluck me from the Savior's hand.
Amen.
But I want you to know that too. So, just know he gave his life for you and me.
He gave his life for mine.
His heart was broken, mine was mended. He became sin, now I am clean. The cross he carried bore my burden. And those nails that held him set me free. His life for mine, his life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die? Suffering brought me
The Turkana people just under southern Sudan in Africa, and thought we kind of had a little break. Now we've got all this stuff going on. We've got a brother back here, Brother Valgeese, did I say that right? And he has works down in South India. We've been praying for the last couple years for the Lord to open a door for us to get down to South India, and I'm glad I met you, son, because I'm going to get you in some trouble. And anyway, we've had a great time. So this morning, we had a staff meeting, and I was talking to some of our staff pastors in Myanmar, and we got on our FaceTime, and we had the FaceTime going, and all the guys was laughing at me. And I said, "What are you guys laughing at?" And over there, they call me Poojay. Yeah. I mean, that's like the grandfather in Myanmar, in Burmese, grandfather is poo-poo.
Oh, no.
And you guessed it, grandma is pee-pee. I'm making that up. I'm not making that up. That's really what it is. And so they call me poo-poo. Poo-jay. And they were just laughing and carrying on, poo-jay, poo-jay, poo-jay. Listen, and I said, why are y'all laughing? Here we are, and all the struggles and everything, and one of my staff guys, Brother Steele, says, Poo-Jay, you are very fat. I said, what? What are you talking about? Tell me something I don't know. And he said, no, no, what are the pictures? What are the pictures? So anyway, your secretary, your wife, took a picture of me the other night, and during when we started, and I'm standing up here behind the podium, and she used the wide angle on the camera. And I didn't have clues. She's talking about, look, it is what it is, son. But when I looked at that picture, I thought, Lord, that looks like an orca. Man, my face is this wide. It looks like I got stung by a bee right on the end of the nose. So we're going to have a brief church meeting and kick Miss Jan out. And we've had such a great time. And Miss Jan, thank you so much. You're a blessing. Brother Tom, we're praying for you. And here's the thing. We have had a great time this week, and I've really enjoyed preaching to you. You're fun to preach to, and we've seen the Lord do things. We've gotten some reports of some that were have trusted the Lord as their Savior in the last day or two, and so we thank the Lord for that. But I just want you to listen tonight, because God's really laid this on my heart, and we're going to have a good time tonight around God's Word. If you would turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of Luke, the book of Romans in chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, and I'm going to begin reading in verse 20. And before we get into our text tonight, let's remember what we've talked about and preached this week from the Word of God. Number one, that when Jesus died on the cross, what He accomplished on the cross. It's so vitally important for God's people to understand what salvation is, how salvation works, how it's applied to us. How is it that we, as believers in Jesus Christ, can say beyond a shadow of a doubt, I know I'm saved, I know I'm going to heaven. Because Amen. The reality is there's people today that say you can't know that. And it's just not true.
That's right. That's right.
It's contrary
That's right.
to Scripture. Right. And we can say that with all confidence because we know from the Word of God what Jesus accomplished on the cross.
Amen.
Everything that is in the Word of God that indicts the sinner to hell, Jesus overcame on the cross.
Amen.
He was God in the flesh, God coming to do what we couldn't do ourselves.
Right.
He overcame the flesh on the cross. He overcame our adversary on the cross, the devil. And He overcame those handwriting of ordinances that were against us. The Bible says in Colossians, nailing them to the cross. And so that's what He accomplished. Then we talked about that redemptive process is what brought on the opportunity for us who deserve hell can know that we have salvation in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We can understand from God's Word what salvation is. We can understand who it's for. We can understand why God extends it because of His grace. How we can receive it, and then what happens if we reject it.
Right.
And then last night we talked about those that will gamble spiritually on their spiritual condition. That they have another chance to be saved, when in fact the Bible says today's the day of salvation.
Right.
Behold,
right.
Now is the accepted time.
Right.
There are those that they'll gamble that God's warnings don't include them. And the thing is, friends, it includes everybody.
Amen.
Everybody will stand before God on their merits.
Right.
And then, that people will gamble that God's warnings aren't as severe as some people say they are. But what I want to talk to you tonight about that we'll find here in the book of Romans chapter 3 is the activation of salvation, or what activates salvation, and how where it takes us as saved sinners. Because the Bible says here in Romans chapter 3 what salvation does for the lost sinner who calls on Jesus Christ. It justifies us.
Amen.
And it's very important for you to understand what justification is. Now, of course, there's a lot of things that come with the salvation that is offered us in Jesus Christ. But I want specifically tonight for us to talk about what it means to be justified. So with that, let's look at our text in verse 20 of chapter 3 in the book of Romans. The Bible declares, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. Are you listening to me tonight? What the Word of God says, for the law is the knowledge of sin. Then he says, but now we have a time change, Paul is saying. Now, the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus,
amen,
whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, at this time His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of him which believe in Jesus. Wherefore is boasting then? Is it excluded? By what law? Of works? Nay, but of the law of grace. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law.
That's right.
Let's ask God's blessing. Father, we thank you today for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to come. And we just ask this day that you would speak to us. God, we ask this day that the Word of God would go out and that the Spirit of God would move and convict hearts, convict lives. And God, as we glean on your Word, I pray that you would give eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to understand. And if there's someone here that does not know you as Savior, I pray today, before it's eternally too late, they will call upon you.
Amen.
We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name till He comes again. Amen.
Amen.
What we read in our text is, and what is being said to us here in the book of Romans, is concerning being justified. You see, under law, God demands that man produce righteousness. But you and I are not under the law in Jesus Christ. We are under grace. Grace. Marvelous grace. And God provides righteousness when you're under grace. You see, the righteousness of God is that righteousness which God's righteousness requires Him to require in order for us to be in His presence. It is that righteousness of God, which is the author from God, which meets and secures God's approval on behalf of a lost man that is called upon Jesus Christ. It is that righteousness which the Father required, the Son of God became, the Holy Spirit convinces of, and faith secures. It is the sum total of all that God commands, all that God demands, and all that God approves of Himself and then provides for us. That's what justification is. It is way more than so many people say, and it is a correct definition to say that justification is being put in a place as just as though you've never sinned. But ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. That is a very, very shallow look at what justification is.
life in the sight of God by the law. Now why is that? Because we know the Bible declares without the shedding of blood there's no remission of sin. The Bible declares that the law does not perfect, and yet we have to be made perfect in the presence of God. So I want you to go with me tonight if you got your Bible. How many of you got it? And if you don't have one, just look on. Because I want you to go with me. We're going to go verse by verse tonight. And I want you to look at this. And I'm telling you, this will bless your soul. And if you're here tonight without Christ, I'm telling you, you can have revealed to you today what it means to be perfected in Jesus Christ. And so you stay with us. Look first of all at verse 21. Verse 21 says, but now. Now stop right there. What a powerful, powerful verse. But the conjunction here is these first two words, now. Now we have evidence of a time change. Now we have evidence of something is different than the way it was. When Paul says, but now, that means not then, now. You see, ladies and gentlemen, way back then, men had to be held to the law, but not now. And so what Paul is saying is, now, under grace, now that Jesus has died for us. You see, then was everything that happened before the cross. And now was that that took place after the cross. Then, we were dead in trespasses and sin. But now, we are quickened and made alive in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Then, my friends, we had no hope. But now we have hope, and we have security, and we have peace that even passes understanding.
That's right.
You see, under the law, nothing's perfected. But now, we're under grace.
Amen.
Give God's word a hand right there.
Amen.
So, righteousness could not be produced by man by keeping the law. And ladies and gentlemen, that's a problem. Because God don't take no dirty laundry.
That's right.
And all we have to offer is filthy rags.
Right.
Isaiah says our righteousness is as filthy rags. And so our filthy rags is not going to get approval from God. And so God Himself provided the righteousness that God Himself required for us to obtain.
Amen.
That's awesome.
Amen.
That's being justified. You see, no one other than Jesus Himself kept the law without ever once breaking it.
Right.
If you look at verse 20, the Bible tells us in our text that no flesh is justified. You look at 2 Corinthians, you'll find that's not justified by the law. You see, the law is God's commandment given in the Old Testament. The law was given to show us that we are sinners. That we cannot measure up. It was a schoolmaster. It's a mirror. And when you look at it, it shows the dirt. It's kind of like Miss Jan's picture of me. My wife, bless her little heart. I tell her about the staff getting after me today, laughing at me. My little chin quivered. Yeah. And listen, this is biblical. Now listen to me. The Bible says that the righteous will wax fat. Is that not true? So I'm just being very, very biblical. See, that's what I say every time I get me a bucket of fried chicken. Yes. Preacher, is that going to be enough? Well, this is enough to make me mad. Give me another bucket. Amen. And anyway, my wife said, Jay, your shirts, your staff shirts are getting too tight. And I said, let me tell you something, woman. See, my wife, now she might, Brother Harold can attest to this, she's a little bit taller than I am. But she is scared to death of me. Oh yeah. Don't you let me tell you something. When I snap my fingers, whoo, you ought to see that woman jump.
No.
Scared to death. Let me tell you this. This is true. So my wife, when we get in a fight, she gets on her knees. That's right. You know what she says? You come out from under that bed. Yeah. She did. So I'm, you know, she's about a less afraid of me this year since you, Brother Cody. She says, Jay, you've got to do something. Your shirt's getting too tight. You're going to put somebody's eye out with a button. Can you believe that? I think that's terrible. But I said, honey, I'm just trying to be biblical. You see, the fact is, we don't measure up. And I said, after that picture and all those guys was laughing at me and everything, I was in a motel room and I was getting ready this morning. And I was... listen, here's what I think. I think the standard is, if you can see your feet, you're not fat. Can I see? And look. I can see all these guys out there going... But you see, the law was given to us to show us that we don't measure up. It brings us to the point of seeing our only hope to go to heaven. Our only hope in being good enough is to trust in Jesus Christ, to repent and call on Him for forgiveness. That's our only hope. Because under the law, God required righteousness from men. But under grace, He gives His righteousness to man.
Amen.
Now look at verse 22. Because now we have this righteousness identified. Even the righteousness of God. Now, listen to me very closely. I'm not talking about God transfers His attribute of righteousness to us. What God does is God gives to us the righteousness that His righteousness requires us to have.
Right.
You see, He makes us righteous. He can take the dirtiest, rottenest, filthy sinner there is, and He can impute the righteousness of Jesus to the extent that we are perfected in the eyes of God.
That's right.
You see, people have the idea nowadays, well, I'm doing pretty good, I haven't murdered anybody, I haven't robbed a bank, listen, we're all at rock bottom.
That's right.
We are either completely lost or completely saved.
Right.
And you see, my friends, what the Word of God is saying to us today is it is provided to us through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's what God does. And His righteousness has been made manifest. That is, it is visible or it is real. It is tangible. Righteousness for all. Righteousness upon all and all those that believe. It's not limited atonement. It's not by works. It's by believing.
Amen.
And then He says, for all have sinned, in verse 23, and come short of the glory of God. All need the righteousness. That's the problem, preacher. So many people just cannot get themselves to a place of understanding that they need the righteousness of Jesus Christ imputed upon them, or they're not going to be saved. Now, I just don't understand why you think I'm so bad. That's not the issue. The issue is we are all unrighteous. And we have to be made righteous.
Amen.
By a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
Right.
You see, we call on Him, we ask Him to save us based on the merits of what He accomplished at the cross. We follow the instructions of the Word of God, and we confess our sins, we confess that He died for us and was buried and rose again, and we ask Him to save us, right?
Amen.
And then we are bestowed upon, the Holy Spirit of God indwells us, and we have now the gift of God, which is eternal life in Jesus Christ. How can God guarantee that? Because the gift is that we've had the imputed righteousness of Jesus.
That's right.
I see you looking at that camera, quit it.
They've been getting on to me.
Hello! They've been getting on to me for getting out of the camera. Well, you better back that camera up, son. You see, He applies that righteousness. And then when that righteousness is applied, that's how you and I... It's not arrogance. I declare myself righteous because of what Jesus did.
Amen.
I declare myself righteous because God provided the righteousness that I needed in order to be perfected in His presence.
Amen.
That's what people can't get. Then look at verse 24. Oh man, this is gorgeous. Being justified freely. Can y'all say that with me? Being justified freely. How much?
Freely.
No, no, no. Can't be that easy. Surely you got to go ahead and finish it off in the baptistry. No, no, it's free. Huh? You see, what baptism is, and this is where people get so wompy jawed. That's an Alabama word, ladies and gentlemen. Wompy jawed. That's the theology right there. Where people get wompy jawed is, I say, well, yes, I believe Jesus died for me, and I'm going to trust Him for my salvation. But then I've got to get baptized to finalize the transaction of salvation. I'm sorry, friends. When you trust Christ as your Savior, and when the imputed righteousness of Jesus is applied, you are perfected.
Amen.
What baptism is a public profession of your faith.
Right.
You're identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why the preacher says, buried in the likeness of His death, raised in the likeness of His glorious resurrection, to walk in newness of life.
Amen.
And we come by that water, I'm identifying with what Jesus Christ did for me. That justification is free.
Amen.
Through Christ Jesus. God had declared all people sinners. But when we trust and believe in Jesus Christ, then God declares us just.
Amen.
Those of us who have fallen short of the glory of God, now we have caught up.
Amen.
You see, Webster says that justification is to be absolved, acquitted, to be declared free from the penalty of sin. And the Bible says, freely. It's the Greek word dorian. It means without cause. In other words, you see, people are so up and down on this idea of salvation and the Word of God. They just cannot grasp the simplicity of it. They can't grasp it. It's just, that's all it is. It's trusting Christ. And then by doing that, God imputes righteousness. And then in God's eyes, you are perfected.
Amen.
And why they have such a hard time with that is because people have a hard time with not being in control of stuff.
Yep.
You got to understand something. I had somebody tell me one time, I was on a train in India, brother, going over and up from Manipur to Sikkim. And I don't know if you know this, but Brother Vagoose can attest to this. If you get on a train in India, you are loaded like cattle in a bull on the trailer, son. I mean, you know how many they're going to put on? All of you. And I'm sitting on that train, and we're going up there, and we're getting up there. We bought our ticket, and we got ready to drive. And I mean, it was going to take a month of Sundays to get up there. And as we got ready to go up there, we were going up into the Sikkim area to begin ministry up in that area and all that. And we began to look at all of the potential that God had in this country and what the Lord could do and the power of God's Word, what it was going to do and all this kind of stuff. And we got up there and I'm sitting there on that train and I'm looking around at all these people and people just cannot get it in their mind that there's not something you have to do along with what Jesus did. But I was sitting on that train and there's a fellow, a businessman from London, and I was talking to him for a minute. It's a funny thing about English people. I don't know if you know this, but they talk funny. So I'm sitting on that note, and he said, well, he said, I just got out of hospital. I said, hospital? Nobody says it like that. What are you talking about? He says, I just got out of hospital. I said, no, you just got out of the hospital, son. Don't leave out the thee. He said, well, what makes you think you're doing it properly? I said, because I'm from Alabama, we're American, and we wrote the English language. Amen. And he says, well, I don't know about that, but I was sitting there with him, and we were talking about, and I got the opportunity to witness to him about the gift of God, which is eternal life in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And he said, I just cannot grasp that God would voluntarily save me and then keep, and then my salvation is never, ever in jeopardy. He said, I can't grasp that. I said, well, let me ask you a question. His name was Claude. Claude, let me ask you a question. So you're telling me you can lose it, right? He says, I believe that, brother. I said, well, bless you. Why'd you say that? I said, because you didn't got what I got. I said, let me ask you something, Claude. Where do you keep it? Is it in your wallet?
Yeah. You carry it in your shirt pocket?
Yeah. This is exactly where it is. Did you lose it, son? That's what they don't understand, man. Right. This is the applied righteousness of Jesus Christ, and it's done by God and honored because of Jesus.
Amen.
Listen, friend, you've got nothing to do with it. That's just right. Take your ego and throw it in the trash.
That's right.
Get over it, friend. We are dirty, rotten, filthy sinners saved by the grace of God, and no, we don't deserve it, but bless God, I have it.
Amen.
By the grace of God. And so it's free.
Amen.
Without a cause. Stay with me. Just as though we have never sinned. And then you got the picture, well, justification, just as though we've never sinned. Yeah, that's true. But friend, it goes way deeper. Because you see, being saved isn't just being forgiven. It's not just minus your sins. It is minus your sins plus His righteousness.
Amen.
And yes, I'm forgiven. But I'm also perfected in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Justification begins with grace.
Amen.
God's riches at Christ's expense.
Amen.
Justification is possible because of the redemption offered us in Jesus Christ at Calvary.
Amen.
And then when we call on Him and we accept His finished works and that alone, we are perfected in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
That's what it means to be saved.
Amen.
You say, wait, how can you know you're saved? Because, brother, you're justified.
Right.
Perfected.
Amen.
You're in that place. Now listen, this is how your salvation works. Well, you're here tonight. You've never trusted Christ as your personal Savior. Then I want to tell you something. Here's a picture. I just want you in your mind's eye to take this picture. We know what happened, what Jesus did when He came. And then the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 1 that Jesus took His disciples to the Mount of Olives, and He'd done many times before, and He put to pray and to teach them. And this particular time after the resurrection, Jesus goes to the Mount of Olives, and as they're praying, the Bible says that Jesus begins to ascend up into heaven. Stay with me. Why? If He came here to secure salvation at Calvary, remember what Jesus said. Listen, it is expedient for me to leave. Because if I don't leave, the Comforter won't come. You need the Comforter here more than you need me here, because I have something to do where I'm going. And so He began to ascend up yonder into glory. And the Bible says that two angels in white came and ascended and looked upon those men. And they said, ye men of Galilee, why are you standing here gazing? See, a few verses earlier, Jesus told them something remarkable. He said, way back about six verses, I want you to go back to Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father. We know from the Gospel of John that the promise of the Father is the Holy Spirit coming.
Amen.
And Jesus then said, right before He began to ascend, He said, listen, you're going to receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you're going to be a witness unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. And then Jesus begins to go up, and as Jesus is going up, the angels come down and they said, you men of Galilee, why are you standing here gazing? For this same Jesus, which is caught up before you, shall so come again in like manner.
Amen.
So shall we ever be with the Lord. Remember that?
Amen.
Don't stay here. You've got to go there, because He's going to empower you. That's the empowerment of the local church. I don't know about you, brother, but I'm a local church man. I believe in the authority of the local church. I believe in the authority of the pastor of the local church. I believe in the authority of the Word of God. Anything else that's authority ain't an authority.
That's right, right.
And He empowered the local church for only one reason, and one reason only, to be a witness.
Hey.
It's the only reason.
That's right.
And so He said, why are you standing here? Get up, go back here, do like the Lord said, because He's going to come back. Why did that happen? He secured redemption at the cross. He rose victorious over death out of the grave. But that's it. Then he leaves. Why? Well, that's exciting, Court, son. You got your fighting clothes on? Come on. Come on. Hey, listen. Why? Because Jesus is involved right now in a present-day ministry.
That's right. That's right.
As our intercessor, as our advocate, and our high priest. You know why I can say beyond a shadow of a doubt that I know I'm saved? I know I'm going to heaven? Wow, that's awful arrogant. No, it ain't arrogance. It's knowing God's worth. Because I have a representative in the presence of God.
Right.
You see, because I have the imputed righteousness of Jesus applied to me, when God looks at this old dirty, rotten, filthy sinner, he sees his son.
Amen.
And the heavenly Father, Jesus then, ascended up into heaven. He went to sit at the right hand of the heavenly Father in a finished work.
That's right. That's right.
Finished. Now, that don't mean for the last 2,100 years, Jesus has been up there sitting at the right hand of the Father twiddling his thumbs.
That's right.
He's involved in something. He's our intercessor, advocate, high priest. See, we got to have representation in the presence of God. And so that's what he does. So here's the picture. Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. The Bible says that the accuser of the brethren accuses the brethren day and night in the presence of God. He's up there pointing the finger.
That's right.
Can you believe that? Cody down there, Lord, that hypocrite. Well, he ate 4 pieces of fried chicken. He's a glutton. By the way, 4 pieces just make me mad. He said, I can't believe you. Now he's up there singing songs about you, and he's doing this. Oh, let's go a little deeper. Let's say you twist off, friend. Let's say the child of God is born again, bought by the blood of Jesus Christ, twists off, gets headlong in sin. By the way, that can happen. And if you've received the gift of God, which is eternal life in Jesus Christ, you're saved.
Amen.
You're losing valuable rewards, though, brother. And the idea that, well, I got to walk this line. Listen, friend, you didn't do nothing to get it, and you can't do nothing to lose it. Because it's not about your righteousness, it's about Jesus' righteousness. Oh, here we go. You Baptists, you have a license to sin. No, I don't. I'm going to tell you something. These spiritual britches have been dusted many a time, friend. God don't let me get away with nothing. I have the fear of the Lord. I'm not about to do something to try to upset him. But boy, when I do, I promise you, I'm on my face. Lord, forgive me. Because that's what he tells us to do. And here's what happens. The accuser, brethren, says, look at that right there. Look at that right there. Can you believe? You mean to tell me that Cody belongs to you? And this is what happens. This is the scene. You have God of glory sitting on the throne of deity. At his right hand, Jesus,
amen.
Savior of the world, he who was dead but is alive forevermore.
Amen.
An accuser of the brethren accuses the brethren day and night. Look at that, Cody. Yeah. Can you believe that? How? By what authority can you, God, declare Cody righteous enough to be in your presence? Jesus, the blessed Savior, says, Dad, I'll handle this one.
Yeah.
By the authority of the nail holes in these hands, by the authority of the holes in these feet, and the holes in his side, he belongs to me because I did what you demanded me to do for him, God.
Amen.
And so he is mine.
Right.
You know what?
That's right.
You can't accuse the child of God that has the imputed righteousness of Jesus.
That's right.
Say amen.
Amen.
That's truth of the matter, friend.
Right.
And see, what happens? That is your salvation at work. And it's because we've been justified. It's possible because of what Jesus Christ did for us at Calvary.
Amen.
If you were to take a white sheet, and you were to take red dye and splash it on that white sheet, that would be a picture of how we are. We are spotted. We are stained with sin. Isaiah says, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, woo, You shall be made white as snow.
Amen.
Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool.
Amen.
You can take that old spotted sheet that's got red dye all over it, put you a pair of rose-colored glasses on it, you don't see no spots.
That's right.
That's how God sees us.
Amen.
You don't see no spots.
That's right.
Is there spots? Yeah, boy, I got them. It's on. But I'm covered.
Amen.
I have the imputed righteousness of Jesus. And listen to me, friend, if you're here without Christ, that's the difference in a saved sinner and a lost sinner. This is what people don't get. Everybody's a sinner. Oh, well, look, not me. My church, you have to sign, you'll have to sign an agreement. You're going to quit sinning. Well, if you do that, you just sin. Because the Bible says, amen?
Yeah.
You know, he that says he has no sin, the truth's not in him, and maketh him to be a liar.
Yeah.
I had a guy one time tell me, I was at a 4th of July deal, we was passing through that gospel tracks, and this guy was up here, he was doing a little street preaching. He said, you got to be perfect, can't sin anymore. If you sin anymore, you're going to get saved again, blah, 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 blah. And he said, he looked at me, he said, sir, you look like you take exception to what I say. I said, I do. He said, why is that? I said, because the Bible says, he that says he hath no sin, the truth is not in him, and he maketh him to be a liar. He said, yeah, but finish the book. Finish the verse. Finish the verse. I said, hey, stupid, that was the last verse in chapter 1. Amen? How about read the book, friend? It's right there. And here we have the Lord Jesus Christ saying, I'll take you when you don't deserve it.
That's right.
And I'll apply my son's righteousness. I'll perfect you so that when you stand in my presence, you can. That's why the Bible says when we go to be in the presence of the Lord, we see him as he is, for we are like him.
Amen.
Woo-hoo, son. I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes. Nobody looking around. When we talk about being justified, that's what we're talking about. Justified in Jesus Christ.